pregame.com.
We're back on pregame.com. I'm Paulie Howard with Teddy Covers. It's the association time. A lot of great things going on in the NBA, and we have to start with the Atlanta Hawks as we tape this. 31-8. They've won 10 in a row. They've been a machine on offense. They're going to go over their season win total by the All-Star break.
Yeah, and that's where we're at right now. You know, we're NBA at the halfway point, so we can take a look and see what happened over the first half of the campaign and try to project forward to see which teams are going to offer value and which teams are going to be strong bet against over the second half of the campaign. And, boy, when you talk about first half, they're going to be called overachievers. Mm-hmm. The Atlanta Hawks at the top of the list. And we're talking about a team, again, Mike Budenholzer, a former Greg Popovich assistant, a longtime Greg Popovich assistant. So we're talking about a team that was built on Spurs-like attributes. No superstars in Atlanta. You know, I mean, Al Horford, you know, he's not a superstar, is he? You know, Paul Millsap, I don't think you can go out in the street and, you know, ask 10 different
good
guys.
Good players, yes.
But not household names. Not when they're out, they're going to move the point spread 4 points type of players. What the Hawks are, they're deep, they're balanced, their ball movement is extraordinary. And the teams without superstars, the teams that have all the players averaging in that 13 to 17 point range, the teams that don't get on national TV, the teams that don't get the hype, They retain their point spread value. We talked about this when we did the first month review after the first month of the NBA season, back in, I think, the beginning of December, we did that podcast. And talking about how the smaller market, non-branded TV, non-national TV teams just retain their values forever. Here's Atlanta. They've won and covered 10 in a row. Teams don't do that in the NBA. You know, they get white hot. They have a flat spot. They get, you know, they win by 9 in a game. They have to win by 13. The Hawks, there's been none of that. It's been a machine.
Yeah. It's amazing. Earlier this week, they were 10-1 to win the East. No one considers them a contender, even though they have the best record. They spanked Washington twice. One of the games was 120-89. They won at Portland, L.A. They beat right in a row. They beat Cleveland by 30 on the road and then beat Dallas and Houston on the road. Yeah. I mean, they're beating elite teams.
I know. And still, even after all the success, I would say that if you bet the Hawks in every game over the next month, you're going to make money. This is not a properly valued team, even after the success that they've had. They are the best team in the East, and they're the best team in the East by a wide margin. And we're going to talk about some other teams that are getting hype as being Eastern Conference contenders. None of them are as good as Atlanta right now, not even close.
This brings us to the Cavs. All the talk of watch out for this team. Kevin Love's getting benched in the fourth quarter. They are 4-15, ATS their last 19. They're below 500. They've lost 6 in a row. And this is off the charts now. I mean, this is Lou's coming in, calling timeouts behind Blatt's back. Players on the Cavs are telling other players that Blatt stinks and needs to go. It's a disaster for Cleveland so far.
And the issues surrounding the Cavs are issues that aren't going anywhere. You know, Kevin Love didn't play defense in Minnesota. He's not playing defense in Cleveland. It's clearly a problem. He hasn't gotten it yet on the defensive end of the floor. That's not going anywhere. LeBron James, he just turned 30. LeBron James is about as old a 30-year-old NBA player as you'll ever see when you're talking about all the playoff minutes and all the regular season minutes and all the Olympic minutes. You know, he's got minutes that, like Kobe Bryant style, you know, where you can project that the 2 weeks that LeBron just took off because he was, you know, he'd worn down, that may be a continuing problem for him over the second half of the campaign. You know, here's Kyrie Irving, he's not dishing the ball. His assist numbers are minuscule. It's a Cleveland bench that isn't very good. Obviously, we've talked about some of the defensive issues, and the defense is getting worse, not better.
Yes.
And with Blatt, there are obviously concerns about the Cavs' ability to improve. And Blatt's going to get his chance to crash and burn. And Cleveland still would be in the playoffs if the season ended today. But we're talking about the Cavs as an abject disaster against the point spread over the first half of the season. If they find some rhythm, this team has the potential to go on a point spread run, a la the Heat. You know, when they found their rhythm second half of the LeBron season, first season in Miami, and they were point spread machines. But I've got to see it before I start betting it. Cleveland is not a team that I'm trying to be proactive on. And right now, The only thing I can do with the Cavs is bet against them again and again and again. They're the gift, one of many gifts that we're going to talk about that just keep on giving.
This is a gift to Pistons. They were 5-23. They tell Josh Smith, get out. They went 8 of 9, and the only loss was to Atlanta. They're playing great ball now.
And the game in Atlanta, they were way behind at halftime and rallied back, and they lost by 3. You know, and the closing spread in that game was +2.5, +3. So they were, you know, even in that contest making money. Not getting blown away off the floor. Now, what really stuck out to me about the Pistons is that they had a bad game at home against New Orleans. You know, and this is a team that was abysmal at the Palace. They've been abysmal at the Palace for years. And they came out and were very flat in the first half against New Orleans. And you look at the quotes following that game, that's their first straight up an ATS loss since before Christmas. And these guys were pissed. Van Gundy was pissed. And you look at Greg Monroe was pissed. And on down the line, this is a team that was like, hey, we don't get games like this anymore. We're playing for a playoff spot now. And, of course, you look at the full season stats for Detroit. They're not good. Their ATS numbers are bad. Their season-long statistics are bad. But if you just break down what they've done since Christmas, since cutting Smith, this has been an elite-level team that has consistently outperformed market expectations, and I think they continue to have point spread potential moving forward.
Let's go rapid fire. How about the Bulls?
Oh, my God, the Bulls. And everyone's talking about the Bulls are the best team in the East. Is nobody else watching Chicago on a nightly basis? You know, Derrick Rose is not a point guard anymore. His assist number, he had three out of four games where he had two assists or less. He doesn't shoot well. He doesn't distribute well. He's not an asset for the Bulls right now. You know, the only game that they've covered, and they covered by a half point against Milwaukee over the last couple of weeks, it was when Gasol goes for 46-18 against the Bucks and their depleted front line. Mm-hmm. That's what they need to cover point spreads. I mean, Jimmy Butler's having a phenomenal season. He certainly is, and a transcendent player, and another guy who's gotten much better in the Thibodeau era. But when you see them losing home and homes to the Wizards, okay, when you see their defense, and their defensive stats aren't even good. The Bulls have been brilliant defensively throughout the Thibodeau era. They were good defensively last year. This year they're mediocre. They're not even good. Mm-hmm. They're not getting crunch time stops. They've been I think they have 2 point spread covers in their last dozen games. And Chicago right now is a one-way team for me. If I'm not betting against the Bulls, I'm not playing the game.
Clippers, bench is atrocious. They've been up and down. And now a nice win last night in Portland.
Well, they've had a couple of wins in the last week that kind of stand out, where they blew out Dallas and they went to Portland and got the straight-up win there. And, of course,
they lost at home to the Heat Sunday.
In between.
What was that?
One of many flat spots. Yeah. And one thing we've seen clearly out of the Clips this year, they have struggled stepping up in class. They've been pretty good at taking care of business against lesser foes. Over the last week, that's reversed. That's flipped. You talk about the bench. I mean, the Clippers bench is designed to open up opportunities for their three-point shooters. They have a ton of three-point shooters on that team. And when you talk about the big men in the middle, DeAndre Jordan and Blake Griffin, and, of course, you know, at the point guard position, you have Paul and Redick, and then you surround those guys with a bunch of shooters, and it's a theory. In theory, it makes sense. I don't think that Doc Rivers' squad has caught their stride yet. And given all of their struggles when stepping up in class over the first half of the season, I think there might be money made with the Clips as underdogs in the weeks and months to come. When they step up in class, I think they'll do better over the back half of the campaign than they did over the first half.
Nuggets.
Denver's a bye team right now. You know, I mean, they've won 5 in a row. They trade Mozgov. Oh, okay, no big deal. They get some assets from Cleveland. They got the rookie and Nesterik. I'm pronouncing his name right. Nustish. I'm bad with.
They got picks. Then they got picks.
Yeah.
Two first round picks for that guy.
I know.
Cleveland's desperate.
They're really desperate. Yeah. You know, the Cavs are all in right now. But Denver's been a very streaky team all year. They have a healthy Ty Lawson right now. They have a healthy Wilson Chandler right now. Their depth is there. And when they're playing at their pace, when they're able to run and gun and push the tempo, particularly against teams, you know, teams always go into the altitude, seems like on the second night of back-to-backs, whether it's Utah or Denver. The Nuggets have the potential to make some people money right now. Again, a team that's outside the major markets that you're not going to see on TV very often, that doesn't have superstars. When teams like that start to play better, it can take weeks, even months, before anyone notices. And right now, the Nuggets are on a little bit of an uptick.
How about the champs? Are we looking at the defending champs as the 7 or the 8 seed in a loaded Western Conference?
Maybe. I'm not bullish on San Antonio against the spread right now. You know, this is a team that hasn't been healthy at any point this season. When it comes to developing that on-court chemistry that's usually so good for the Spurs, it's not there right now. And you watch them play, you see it. You know, they're still enormously talented. They're still very, very deep. And I certainly think that once April and May roll around, San Antonio is going to be a tough out. But I really think that the Spurs right now in this loaded Western Conference, they're not as good as the elite teams, and it's showing on the floor. And I think there's money to be made betting against San Antonio because everyone expects, oh, it's the Spurs, they'll be fine.
You're right, right.
And I'm not so sure this Spurs team is fine. I think the last year may have been their final run with this core group.
Let's save the best for last, the Knicks. Oh, what a dumpster fire. This is great. The Boo Birds are out there wearing bags over their heads. Fire Fisher chance in the first quarter. I don't think they're going to win 10 games. They shut Melo down for the rest of the year if that happens.
Well, Melo coming back for the game in London against the Bucks. Amari's coming back for the game in London. Of course, the markets are giving those two players respect, which is baffling to me because they're no better with Melo on the floor than they are without him. You know, well, No better against the spread, certainly. I mean, when you look at the entirety of this Knicks roster, there's not a shot creator, there's not a low post defensive presence, there's not a dynamic point guard. You know, I mean, Calderon's going to be out of there.
Yes.
And Calderon, you know, what all the veterans are doing in Madison Square Garden right now are playing for checks and playing for their chance to get out of town because there's nothing positive with that team. And, of course, major market, they have a superstar, they're on TV all the time. Everyone knows how bad the Knicks have been. Against the spread, they've been getting clocked. But you don't make money in the NBA supporting the very worst teams. Even with all of this added value on the Knicks, you know, they've gotten some of their guys back, and they have played so poorly over the first half of the campaign. The answer for me is not with my money, my friend. You want to take value with the Knicks, go for it. Not me. And certainly not at Madison Square Garden, where there is absolutely no home court edge for the Knicks. In fact, they've been playing worse at home, both straight up and against the spread, for the better part of the last 2 months.
Been a fun start to the season, and it's going to continue. Some good stuff there from Teddy Covers.
Hey, it's not about fun. It's about making money.
You're right. You're right. Golden State, Atlanta, Detroit. You see how well Portland's playing, and a lot of teams, especially in the Western Conference, making some moves, making some trades, because that's going to be fun in playoff time. We'll see you next time on pregame.com.